I call it a gem.
Isn't that beautiful?
Yeah. You know, this house holds such special memories. We once lived upstairs with five kids and actually had these bedrooms for the boys. Yeah. Then they all moved out and we just decided to move downstairs.
And we have a kitchen here, beautifully designed and fabricated by our son John, who is a building contractor.
Yes, it used to be a furnace room.
A furnace room. You want to look where the furnace used to be?
Yeah, right there.
Right there.
And then we have a custom-made table that Devon made for us.
He's our youngest son.
Actually, the three sons got involved in this project. Remember, Byron was here too. Right. So this is a special room, my library. But oh, what a wonderful place this is. Our honeymoon cottage, honey. We had to show our deck. You know, I enjoy this deck and the roses.
Uh-huh. Except when it's either too windy or too hot.
Yes, but it's lovely here. I've enjoyed it for many, many months. I remember Edgar coming up to me and grabbing my hat and taking it off, and I knew he was a very shy person, but here he'd taken off my man hat and put it on his head and was just kind of goofing around and laughing and enjoying himself with me.
Eula got a job at the Royal Bakery in Logan.
Oh,
yes.
She was
behind the counter. She was serving purchases to people coming there to buy, and I was quite enthralled by her. I didn't dare go in there alone, but I managed to go in with my sister Valoy, and I'd go into that royal bakery to see my royal queen.
And lo and behold, after about the third time, he came in by himself, and he said, "Would you go someplace with me?" I don't remember where it was.
I remember one of the experiences we had up in the mountains, enjoying the babbling brook, and I was so enthralled with my sweetheart that I thought maybe now would be a good time to ask her if we should get married. And so I said, "How about it?" She paused a moment and she said, "Well, why don't we wait till November 8th? August 22nd, she said that. November 8th happened to be the birthday anniversary of her youngest brother. And I thought, well, that sounds very promising. She likes to have special occasions happen on special days. I didn't propose to her again until November 8th. But in the meantime, we went to the jewelry store and found a neat little pair of rings, an engagement ring and a wedding ring. And the two of us together decided what to buy, and stood in the shade of a beautiful big pine tree, I think it was, as I recall. I asked her, "Eula, will you marry me?" She said, "Yes, I will. Thank you for asking," or something like that. I was subject to be drafted into the Navy because we had a war going on.
Yeah, that's true.
And she didn't want me to be married to her and go off to war. And I got a book in the file drawer there, about this thick of love letters we wrote back and forth.
Yeah.
During my experience in the Navy.
I'm glad you suggested we do it that way.
So we got loosely folded. We agreed to use same size paper to write letters back and forth, so they all fit in the same folder. I was released from the Navy on my mother's birthday anniversary, May 18th, 1946.
And you were married June 27th, 1946.
Yeah. And I've got a special gift for my little newlywed. This is something Eula hasn't seen for 50 years.
My goodness, my hair. That's what it is, isn't it?
50-year-old sample of Eula's hair.
Oh, my goodness.
And she didn't even know I had it. You were getting your hair trimmed and redone, you know, fixing up fancy for the wedding.
Oh.
And some of it was spilling on the floor, and I just had the gumption to pick it up off the floor and stick it in an envelope and save it somehow.
Byron. That's all, had yeah. Byron when we were still in that one-bedroom apartment.
Combination bedroom, living room, kitchen, etc.
We had a coal range, big kitchen sink, a table, of course, and chairs, and our big bed, very comfortable bed, and our piano. We had a piano, too, because I like practicing the piano.
I remember when I was 7 or 8 years old, living in this little red brick house back in Utah. My dad and I had a little workshop up in the attic, and we used to build electric motors and solenoids and buzzers and just all this electrical experiment stuff that, you know, because my dad was really into that, and so he was teaching me all this. And yeah, we had 15,000 volt transformer that we made a Jacob's ladder where the spark goes up like you see in horror movies, kind of like Frankenstein's lab, you know, and we just did all these experiments, and it's a really fond memory for me. And I guess that's why nowadays I like to surround myself with so many wires and electronic gizmos and things like that.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome back to the program, Todd Rundgren.
I just discovered that I really enjoy expressing myself in picture and then writing about it. And so here I just wanted to write something about peaceful times, and I first drew the picture and then wrote about how I feel about spending quiet time with God, for instance.
One memory that I have with Mother that I would like to share, and that was there was an old folks home called Sunshine Terrace in Logan that we would go to often and visit some of the elderly people there. Some of the very warm memories and also some very alarming memories when some of the older people might get a little bit angry, want to know why these little children are in here bothering them. But that was rare. Most of the time they were very pleasant, and Mother was of course there to love them and to bring a little bit of happiness into their life. But I always remember that. Something that I vividly remember with my dad, and that was he was the one that taught me how to use a hammer and how to make things with wood and nails. That was one of my most favorite things to do, was to build with that hammer and make little boats and little things with wood. I just love to do that. And of course,
oh, here's the hand of God I was thinking about. See his hand? I see him holding me in his hand.
Mom and Dad always had a way of making me feel like I could do just about anything, and I appreciated them for that. Mom used to sell World Book, and quite often she'd come across families that were too poor, couldn't afford the World Book, and so Mom would always work out these deals with them where she would trade. One time she traded for singing lessons for me. Another time she traded for poetry lessons for all of us. In my freshman year in high school I went to was kind of a rough school. And I remember there was a lot of fighting that would go on. Then I got in with a group of kids that I should not have been in with. To get in with them, I dumped my other friends, which was not a good thing for me to do. It turned out it was just a big disaster, and I did not fit in with these kids, and I couldn't go back to my old friends because they were mad at me for dumping them. So I found myself friendless for this period of time in this awful school. And one of my girlfriends that I had dumped ended up moving to the other side of town to live with her mother, and we made up and became friends again. And she invited me to her birthday party, which was on a Sunday. So we spent the night, and I went to school with her, and I decided I wanted to stay there. It was a smaller school. The kids were a lot nicer. So they agreed to let me continue going to school there. And my parents did find a home and moved the whole family there so that I could go to school there, and I just was impressed that they would go to that much trouble for me.
Jesus. And so I drew the scene of Daniel in the lion's den to illustrate this idea of fix your eyes on Jesus. And I just find it so fun to express myself in this kind of drawing.
When Devon and I were about 11 and 12 years old, we were doing the summer Bible school thing at the Evangelical Free Church, which was about 2 miles away from our home. And on one particularly hot, sweltering summer day, we finished up early in the afternoon and didn't feel like walking home like we were supposed to, so we called. And Dad picked up, and we explained the situation. Dad, it's so hot. Can you come and get us? And without skipping a beat, he said, why, sure, no problem. You just start walking and I'll meet you. So we started walking, and we kept walking, and we kept walking, and we kept walking, and finally we were starting to get a little irritated because there was no Dad. And we were about halfway home when we saw this little figure in the distance approaching us. And the closer it got, the more we realized that that was Dad walking to come and get us. So by the time he got there, we'd worked up quite a little frenzy and said, Dad, why are you walking? We asked you to come and pick us up. And with perfectly innocent eyes, he said, well, no, actually, you asked me to come and get you, and that's what I'm doing. And we said, well, why didn't you bring the car? And he said, well, I couldn't, because your mom has it. And then he proceeded to take a picture of us, which he had brought a camera for the purpose of doing. And I've always appreciated that memory, because instead of just saying, no, I don't have a car, quit bothering me, walk home, you know, he had a little fun with us. He went out of his way to walk those same 2 miles in that same sweltering heat to play a joke on us and to make a point, I think, maybe even a couple of points. If things aren't working out perfectly the way you want them to, have fun. Have fun with it. Have fun with life. With life. And also, when you're trying to express something really important, be very specific.
This is the book of Philippians. It's a book of joy, and I wanted to express joy, and so that's the way I did it.
I have a recollection of a time in my childhood. I guess I was 6 or 7 years old, and I was out working in the garden. I was shoveling away and pulling weeds, and all of a sudden the thought struck me. I'm out here working, and I'm not getting anything for it. And it struck me because I remember a certain progression that had brought me to this place. I remember when I was about 2 years younger, maybe 4 or 5 years old, if I wanted some candy, I'd ask my mom or my dad for candy, and they'd say, okay, well, here's a quarter, and my mom would take me to the store, and we'd get some candy, and I'd be happy. As time went on, I'd ask my mom for some money for some candy, and she'd say, well, sure, you can have some money for candy, but you're gonna have to work for it. So she'd put me out to work in her garden, and I'd pull weeds, and I'd water, and I'd do whatever I had to. Then I'd get my quarter and go get my candy. Well, as time went on, somehow things had progressed to the point where I just had to work in the garden because I was part of the family, and that's what I had to do. And that's the thought that struck me. And the reason I'm telling this story is I just wanted to thank you, Mom and Dad, for instilling the work ethic in all of us.
Being changed into God's image, here's another one, letting Him just, you know, chisel away at you.
One thing I love about the folks is their dedication to their family and their teamwork that's demonstrated in a recent event. I came downstairs to the laundry room and it was flooding rapidly. The water was moving into the studio. I looked in here and there were wires all over the floor, and as always, and the red lights and the green lights were blinking, which meant everything was plugged in. Byron was gone for the day. And I could just envision fireworks and maybe computers being wiped out. I got on the phone and called Ed and Eula and said, help. And they dropped everything and ran here. And immediately, Ed figured out a trick to stop the water and basically saved the day. They worked together for a while, helped me clean up, and that's the kind of thing they always do. They drop everything, and they help out, and we love them and appreciate them so much.
thing I love about Eula and Ed, are they're very open people. They're very kind and they're very generous. And they're very supportive. And they both tell me on a regular basis that they love me. And those are strong words that a lot of people are afraid to admit or that they don't tend to admit. But it's very comfortable and it's very natural for them to say it.
As a little girl, I've adopted in Mississippi, and I just fell in love with her.
What I remember most about Grandma and Grandpa were the walks that we would take. And we would be walking alongside the road, and both of them would start singing to us. And so then we would listen, and we'd sing along. And then Grandma would start explaining the type of bushes and trees that were along the road and telling us how great God's world is. And then sometimes we would take walks to the shopping market, and we would look at everything that they had to sell, and then we'd find an escalator, and we'd ride it up, and we'd ride it down, and we'd ride it up, and we'd ride it down. Oh, sorry, and then we'd go home.
We know, listening to all these stories that you have to tell about them, I wish I could have known them, you know, when they were younger, and when, I mean, they're still young. Stop! That's not how I meant it to go. I wish I could have been there with you because they seem so fun and loving and caring. And they do put people before them all the time. I remember Grandpa's little cubbyhole in the kitchen when he pulled the picture away from the wall. There's a little cubbyhole. We'd always go down there and play on the computer. And it was just kind of like a little hideaway. And he was always so inventive. He always created things out of, you know, he's a regular MacGyver, just bubblegum. MacGyver can, it's a TV show. And like, if he's stuck in a life and death situation, like a bomb's about to go off in 2 minutes, if he has a piece of bubblegum in his mouth and a safety pin, he could save the world. You know?
And someone once was praying for me, and she said, you know, I see a little girl dancing. And so I thought, yeah, that's the way I feel inside of me, like a little girl who likes to dance. And so I'm dancing. And I like to pray for people. So I'm here praying, kneeling in the gap.
Well, Mom and Dad, I think over the years, the hallmark of what I've been so impressed with both of you is your never-ending generosity. I know that I personally have benefited from it over and over again in the raising of my family. You were always there to help me with the kids. I remember when Ben was just a very active little baby, I came down with a whopper flu, and you came over and got him and took him home for 2 days because I couldn't even get out of bed. And besides the kids, the help over the years with our house, with moving. You helped when my mom was ill, and you helped take care of James for me when I needed to take care of her. And also, Mom, I really have been impressed with how you've developed your sense of style over the years and learning how to dress really well, colors, and decorating your house and being interested in those things that you never had time for as a young mom and a young woman. I just want to thank you both for the heritage that you've given my children and our family, and for the help that you've given both Devon and I, because there's been times when we've really needed an extra hand many times. And I know that our family has benefited and developed in a healthy way because of it.
All right, well, I remember this time around Christmas time when I was getting my parents, we didn't really have the money to get piano lessons, and I was really worried because, I don't know, I was thought I was going to lose it, but then I got a card from Grandma and Grandpa, and I opened it up, and in it it said that they were going to pay for my piano lessons for a year, and that was about the greatest thing they ever could have given me, because now I'm getting back into piano, and I can play real well now. And I remember a few other times when they've, you know, I've called him up whenever I need something from Grandpa, maybe something from his garage for a project I have, or anything else. I can always count on them. They're really reliable. Thank you so much for always being there, Grandma and Grandpa, and always loving through the years.
Hello, Grandma and Grandpa.
Oh, that's great.
I just remember a lot of games and stories you've told us,
games you've taught us. And I remember when I was four, Grandpa brought me into his bedroom, got out the chessboard, and taught me how to play chess, and I'm pretty good at it now. And I remember he had always taken me into his computer room and show us the new games he had made on his computer. They were pretty good because he just thought them up himself, especially bingo. That was really good. And I just wanted to thank you for all the nature walks you've taken us. And I just want to say that you're the greatest grandparents anybody could ever have.
Grandma and Grandpa, I remember all those times that you let me go under the house, and all those times that we made waffles, and whenever I go there, Grandpa has something on the computer, a design or a game. And I also love playing bingo a lot there. And it's really fun when we just have a great time and be together.
51 years ago this month, I was in the Navy and had been overseas, came back to Long Beach, California. I found a recording booth where I dropped a quarter in the slot. And then I was able to speak and record a song that I made up in honor of my fiance, Eula Johnson. Eula, Eula, you love me, you do, that's plain to see. Eula, Eula, you love me, I'm proud as I can be. Whenever I look you over, my heart beats twice as fast to think that I have met you and found my dream at last. Eula, Eula, you love me, you've proven that before. Eula, Eula, you love me, and you I do adore. And when the war is over, I'll do my level best to please you and the children in our own little love nest. Eula, Eula, you love me, you thrill me with your smile. Eula, Eula, you love me, you make my life worthwhile. The Navy will not change me, temptation has no threat. And soon I'll be back with you, cause you're my favorite pet.
So
Day and age, it's really hard to find a couple that are really happy and in love and so youthful in their marriage for 50 years. And I want to thank you for being an inspiration. I hope that when I get married, you know, my marriage is just like yours.
Hap.
P.
No!
No, you say E.
Well, there's two P's in it. Hap.
No, you go happy. You don't go happy. You go happy.
Happy.
Okay, let's try to get past the first word here.
You say happy
50th
wedding
anniversary.
Grandma and Grandpa. That's
the worst. We love you.
We love you.
Happy anniversary.
Happy 50th anniversary, Grandma and Grandpa. This dunk's for you.
I love you, man.
Sisters with me, and my nieces and nephews. Hello, Dimples. Today, June 19, 1945, I want to try to express the joy I experience in knowing how sincerely you care for me. The past few weeks have brought me a happiness which cannot be described in mere words. I have never before felt with such complete assurance that you and I are truly in love. May God be with us always. And now, here is my song. I was inspired to compose it one recent lonely night while I was on guard duty. It isn't much, but it's the first I've ever written, and it's for you, Vernon, because I love you. Eula, Eula, you love me. You do, that's plain to see.
Eula, Eula, you love me. I'm proud as I can be. Whenever I look you over, my heart beats twice as fast. To think that I have met you and found my dream at last. Eula, Eula, you love me. You've proven that before. Eula, Eula, you love me. And you I do adore. And when the war is over, I'll do my level best to please you and the children in our own room of rest. You lie, you lie, you love me. You thrill me with your smile. You lie, you lie, you love me. You make life more worthwhile. A baby will not change me. Temptation holds no threat. And clean, I'll come back to you, for you're my precious pet.
I'm anxious to see if we've made any progress.
Thank you.
let Mark please do one.
For Grandma, do a pretty dance. Whoa!
You are the best great grandma ever. I love you.
Oh.
How beautiful.
Jesus loved me and just sign up for the Bible, loves me so.
Beautiful. Jesus loves me, the Bible tells me so.
So beautiful, yes she is beautiful. Beautiful, she loves animals. Look, she's hugging that little puppy. She's hugging the little puppy, hugging, hugging. Hugging, hugging.
This is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made.
Turn to Him. Just turn to God. Just to feel His presence. It's worth millions of dollars.